this guy too.
For your host of the Goldenrod Showboat, Mr. John Auble.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this monumental brunch as we kick off the 21st annual National Ragtime and Classic Jazz Festival aboard the Goldenrod Showboat. We play this song, Here Comes the Showboat, as part of the tradition on Goldenrod, and we play that before every performance here in our theater, and we saw no reason to change that format for today. I do want you to give a big round of applause. This is this guy's first jazz festival. He started as a bartender with us, took the ragtime music, self-taught himself with the help of some musicians that came aboard from time to time. He has never appeared in a festival before. He's on the stage today. I think he did a wonderful job. Ray, my bye. He's our part-time, he listens to Cardinal baseball all the time and he plays ragtime. It's probably the first time that's ever been done by a ragtime musician. He can tell you the score at any particular time in the game. Did you know that baseball was in the Bible? Were you aware of that? I was looking through the Bible for a little inspiration before today's opening and I saw there in the beginning. We got nothing but groaners. Eve stole first and Adam second. St. Peter umpired the big game. Rebecca went to the well with the pitcher. And Ruth in the field gained fame. Goliath was struck out by David. There was a hit made on Abel by Cain. The prodigal son made one home run. And Brother Noah gave out checks for rain. It's all in the Bible. Everything you ever want to know about anything. Well, that has nothing at all to do with why we are here. We are here to dedicate this festival to a gentleman whose photograph appears on my left, Mr. Ferdinand Jelly Roll Morton, who was born in New Orleans back in 1885, exactly 100 years ago. The very flamboyant Jelly Roll, who used to call himself the world's greatest hot tune writer, is a symbol for musicians everywhere who have copied his style and his technique and certainly played through the years a number of his instrumental renditions. Considering such songs as the original Jelly Roll Blues, Mr. Jelly Lord, and of course the one that we'll kick off this festival with, which is called No One's Gonna Get a Piece of My Sweet Jelly Roll. He has an imprint upon American music, has been enormous, and we're delighted to be able to feature him and honor him in this particular way during the festival. We have a great lineup for you throughout the entire 8 days. The first time the festival has been extended to 8 days. We are now proudly the granddaddy of all the festivals in the United States. New Orleans, as most of you know, dropped out of it last year. The R.J. Reynolds Company pulled the cool jazz off the circuit this year, so there are precious few jazz festivals left. Hardly any of ragtime festivals left. And we have been around for, this festival has been in existence for 21 years. We have been involved with it for the past two, and hope we can continue the fine tradition that was started here by our host band, the St. Louis Ragtimers. I want to thank for the next week in St. Louis, and for those of you from out of town, we certainly welcome you to this town and to the boat in particular. For the next 8 days, Goldenrod will be the storm center of syncopation. The Ragtimers, for those of you from St. Louis and perhaps from elsewhere, are no strangers to you and or to ragtime music, but I do want to introduce them individually so that they get the credit they deserve. It was 21 years ago that a gentleman named Traber Tischner, Traber, which is Robert spelled backwards, in case you were wondering, his folks had a sense of humor, undoubtedly. Traber Tischner, who is a big part of a couple of works,
a big part of it.
Novels that have just been published, one called A Ragtime by John Edward Hosse, who is due aboard sometime this week, and another called U.B. Blake by Al Rose, who is also due to be a part of this festival as the days progress. But this gentleman with the St. Louis Ragtime has not only lent his abilities and his talents to the origin of this festival, but he is also a big part of ragtime history. He is indeed a legend. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Traber Tischner, the old professor. Come on, please. Thank you. And the idea about a ragtime festival began taking root 21 years ago with Mr. Frank Pearson. A couple of other members of the ragtime, St. Louis Ragtimers, quickly jumped aboard and championed the cause, making it at the beginning, what was it, Traber, a one-day event when it started? 1 or 2 days back 21 years ago. And the two gentlemen that gave enormous early help to that, I have no particular order for introducing them, so I'll do it alphabetically. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Don Franz. Don, here he is. Don's got a little weight to allow him to come on that. You can come out with me too, though. Thank you, Don. Don is sort of the spokesman for the group, and we'll give you a word of welcome, I'm sure.
Welcome.
Thank you, Don, very much. That's about as much as I've heard Don talk in my entire career. Do you have a chair, Don, or are you going to just... Yeah, why don't you bring that and let Don sit down and get into position. The other gentleman who is does a lot of the vocals for the Ragtimers, one of the founders of this wonderful group, great banjoist, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Al Stricker. And the two newer members of the Ragtimers, although saying new with a group that's been together as long as these guys is not really appropriate, but we want, I don't know which one joined the Ragtimers first. Was it Bill? Bill? All right, let's welcome him. The great cornetist, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Bill Mason. Come on, will you? Gentlemen, of course, have become part of what we call the host band. They'll be playing every night of this festival, and will be committed to an asylum about the next day after. So, ladies and gentlemen, the great clarinetist, Mr. Eric Seeger. Eric, come on out with the entry stick, okay? Where are you going, this time? Is that okay for you? Great. Thanks, Eric. Eric's the one with the sense of humor of this little group. He's... What was the story he told me today? It was so bad I almost forgot it, but he comes up with these jokes from time to time about, I can't think of what it was. Was it, he said that buckwheat, you know, buckwheat with the little rascals, became a black Muslim. Did you hear about that? He's changed his name to Kareem of Wheat. Now, listen, I've got to put up with this from this guy, see? This guy is really drunk. He said to me, what was Captain Hook's name before he lost his hand?
I said, I don't know, Eric, what was it? He said, cap in hand. Fortunately, they can play better than they can perform humor. And maybe I lost something in the translation. All right, the festival is dedicated to Mr. Jelly Lord, and in honor of that, we're going to kick this festival. Excuse me, Donnie, all right? Oh, excuse me. We're going to kick it off with one of the great tunes of Jelly Roll Morton. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoy them. The Salty Dogs will be here following the Ragtimers, and then, of course, Keith Smith, Hefty Jazz Band from London, England, will be here, and you'll really get a kick out of both of those groups. But we're going to start things off with Nobody Can Have a Piece of My Sweet Jelly. That's not it. See, the purist. Every time I start something, I look at the purist and his eyes go blank, and I know that I've screwed it up somewhere along the line. What is the title of it, Al?
Tank Town Bum.
Tank Town Bum? Aren't we doing a Jelly Roll Morton tune? Oh, that is a Jelly Roll Morton tune. All right, well, this Tank Town Bum is going to say goodbye to you, fellas. You're leaving it in good hands. Thank you so much for being with us. We enjoy having you.
Said, we're the St. Louis Ragtimers, non-profit organization. We didn't plan it that way, but that's the way it is. Here we go, though. We are going to do a Jelly Roll Morton tune. He wrote several bump tunes in his career. Just what that inferred, we're not sure, but they were New Orleans bump, Courthouse bump, and this one that we always kind of find fun to play, Tank Town Bump. So, Professor, bring it in.
Thank you.
Grace and Beauty, written by a youngster from Kansas City by the name of Jimmy Scott about 1990 and so on. I always like to say that at the outset of these shows, particularly at a festival. We're playing the music of kids here, you know. I took the time to figure out the age of the composers of what I'm going to do this afternoon at the time the things were published, and it was somewhere between 21 and 22 years of age. Popular music has always belonged to the kids, hasn't it? And ragtime was America's first pop, I think. For instance, 1900, a couple of young fellows, teenagers out of southern Indiana, Gene Jefferson, Bobby Roberts, they ran away from home to go on the road with this new music and vaudeville act. Ragtime, two words in those days, you know. Gene's mother, they say, told him no good could come of it, that ragtime was a scurrilous music, reeking of excessive syncopations. Gene's father wanted the boy to learn a trade. Harness making, or at least go to law school.
And welcome to the Goldenrod Showboat for the 21st Ragtime Festival, traditional jazz too, of course. We're the original Salty Dogs, and we've been down here about 23 of them. We got here first, but we didn't tell anybody about it for a couple of years. But that was a song called My Heart, written by Lil Armstrong. And here's another great addition to our band, who's been with us for a long, long time now, Miss Carol Lee.
All right, are you ready? Okay, here we go. Tell me what is wrong with me. My man, we can't agree. Now he's tried to steal away. That is why you'll hear me say, now I've got the blues. Yes, I've got the blues. I'm gonna sing 'em night and day. Ticket agent, ease your window down. Ticket agent, ease your window down. You know my man has quit me.
Thank you very much. We'd like to play a very pretty tune, which used to be Louis Armstrong's signature tune. It's entitled Sleepy Time Down South. Thank you.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, a warm Goldenrod Showboat welcome for Mr. Steve Hancock and his red-hot ragtime guitar. Thank you.
jazz band from Memphis, Tennessee.
Thank you. I'm Henry Thins Francis, and so you know why they call me Thins, don't you? It's because I play like Fats Waller, and I'm going to play like Fats Waller right now, and I'm going to play Handful of Keys by Fats Waller.
Thank you. horse feathers.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Tom McDermott. I'm from New Orleans. I grew up here, but I moved to New Orleans a couple years ago. I'll be playing some rag and some stride and maybe some boogie-woogie and New Orleans-type music. Here's a Fats Waller piece. One of these most famous standards, Honeysuckle Rose.
Say good evening, everybody. Oh, that's wonderful. It's just like the old British music halls. Terrific. My name is Ian Whitcomb from London in England and Pasadena. This is my friend and partner, Richard Zimmerman, from Santa Barbara and Los Angeles Airport, which is where he now lives. But anyway, we do, you know, American British songs and classic ragtime and not so classic ragtime, and but no rock and roll tonight. And but it bought me all these clothes. But anyway, the thing is, the first song I'm going to sing tonight is one of those wonderful songs about American states, because there are so many songs about these marvelous, mellifluous sounding states you've got here, like, you know, Alabama and Georgia and California and, of course, Missouri and so forth. And in England, we don't have such lovely sounding names. We just have counties like Dorset and Middlesex, and you just can't rhyme with them. So I'm going to sing you a song about the state of Georgia. And I have a personal interest in this because my cousin married a Georgia Bellamy, live happily with lots of children in Atlanta. So here it is. Everything is peaches down in Georgia, written by George Meyer in 1917. Dick. Down in Georgia, there are peaches waiting for you. Yes, and each is sweet as any peach that you could look for on a tree. Georgia peaches, they are famous, down there's where they grow. My folks write me, they invite me, don't you want to go? Everything is peaches down in Georgia. What a wonderful climb for a hell of a time. Believe me, paradise is waiting down there for ya. I got a peach of a ma, a peach of a pa. Oh, what a peach of a couple they are. There's a preacher preaches down in Georgia, always ready to say, will you love and obey? That's where I'll get myself a peach of a wife. Settle down for a peach of a life, 'cause everything is peaches down in Georgia. Go, Dickie! Good song, isn't it? Paradise is waiting down there for ya. I got a peach of a ma, a peach of a pa. Oh, what a peach of a couple they are. Now there's a preacher who reaches down in Georgia. Hallelujah, honey baby, always ready to say, yes I am. Where you love and obey, oh honey baby. That's where I'll find myself a peach of a wife. Settle down for a peach of a bloody life, cause everything is peaches down in Georgia. Everything is peaches down Georgia.
Wow. And this, of course, is the Flash in the Pan Jazz Band from Mobile.
That B flat.
Jelly roll,
jelly roll.
I wouldn't part with a piece of that cake to save my soul.
Save my soul.
My ma told me today,
what she
just
say?
Before she went away, be a good boy, she'd buy me a toy. I'm my mama's only pride and joy. There ain't no use for you to keep on hanging around.
Hanging it out.
Sorry, but I'll have to turn you down, down, down. My jelly roll is sweet, and I know it's hard to beat, but you can't have it, and I ain't gonna give it none of my jelly roll. Tell them, Sonny.
Thank you.
nobody none of my jelly roll.
Jelly roll.
I wouldn't part with a piece of that cake to save my soul.
Save my soul.
My ma told me today.
What'd she say?
Before she went away. If I'd be a good boy, she'd buy me a toy. I'm my mama's only pride and joy. There ain't no use for you to keep on hanging around.
Hanging it out.
Sorry, but I'll have to turn you down, down, down. My jelly roll is sweet, and I know it's hard to beat. But you can't have it, and I ain't gonna give it none of my jelly roll. Well, you can't have it, I ain't gonna give it none of my jelly roll.
Thank you, boy. Thank you, folks. You're more than kind.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are the Sons of Bix. And we might as well get the introductions out of the way early so we can get on with the business of playing some music for you. So we specialize in the music associated with Bix Beiderbecke. And that would, of course, be the Gene Gold Kit, Paul Wakeman, Aaron. A very fine Chicago and New York blend of the white jazz of the flapper age. High Art Deco music, folks. This was a tune that Red Nichols sort of rewrote Allah's Holiday, and he came up, called it Bassman's Holiday. He featured Joe Rushton with his band back about 30 years, and we're going to feature John Otto on Bassman's Holiday. Gentlemen.
We're going to do another George Gershwin song. This one is one that we just started doing called Liza. Or Lisa.
Lisa with an S.
Say, please, I am telling you guys, please don't talk about me when I'm gone. It's quite clear our friendship ceases from now on. And if you can't say anything real nice,
yes,
I do hope you won't say anything at all. In fact, honey, I'm giving you that advice. We're parting. You go your way. I'll go mine. Don't try to talk me out of it. It's best that we do. But don't go away mad, darling. Here's a little kiss.
I don't think she
I hope it brings
that.
A lot of luck to you.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, you guys got one thing straight. You understand?
Yes.
It isn't any of your business anymore how I carry on. I don't care whether I'm late, whether I forget the music, whether I forget the payroll.
Whoop. Got a line somewhere.
Because what I mean is, please don't talk about you when I'm gone. Thank you.
I don't know what we're going to do with her, but here she is. What a title. St. Louis's very, very, very first lady of jazz, Jeannie Kittrell. Jeannie, I don't know. After 9 years of working with you, I haven't lost any weight, but I've sure lost a lot of hair. I don't know what it is.
But I'm not talking about that. We have 27 beers, please. Charge them to Mr. Auble's room. By the way, Mary here has been running the sound on this boat. Isn't she doing a great job, huh? Boy, you can really hear this boat.
I just want to give credit to my crew, Bob Earl and John, who have been outside stages in the dining room, and also my technical director, Dave Sharp, who actually masterminds all the electronics and makes me look real good. So, Dave, thanks.
She looks real good anyway. Now, I remember years ago when we played this boat, we had one wind-up microphone, and that was it.
He was in showboat business way before that. His kids out of school, that's how they got into showboating. They made their own little boat and just came downstream. And where they ended up was near a showboat that had, who's the guy that did... French, Captain French.
Oh, yeah.
And he had as time went on, he made 5 major showboats.
Right.
Starting in the mid-1800s. Right. Mankey and his brother, just kids out of school, they got to meet Captain French. He was invited on board, and he was hired as an agent. He would work ahead of the... Wasn't long till after that he actually bought into a boat.
Right.
And I don't know if the Goldenrod was the first. I think he acquired it around 1920, but he was in the business
before then.
Yeah. This kid came aboard with can you hire me to do something, you know? Yeah. And he was hired by Captain Mankey to help with the boat.
The deckhand,
right. And within a couple of weeks or a month or so, one of the main actors in the melodrama was ill, and they needed a sub, and they put Red Skelton in there. This is interesting because it shows the cast. That's their staterooms.
Oh, yeah.
And you can see the actor and actresses there.
Looking down at the limo.
Yeah.
I wish he'd take us out for some steak.
There's that limo again Captain Minky's. It has a wooden hull.
Oh, yeah.
At this point.
At that point, yeah. That's probably right before the... And disaster.
This was one of Captain Mankey enjoyed buying and trading and
push boats,
towboats. Yeah. And this was used to move the Goldenrod.
Sure, which was really just a barge.
Right.
Even it would haul at that time.
Right.
But
And this was in the newspaper. And it's just pointed out in 1944. Now look at the hull. That's after 1947. A huge towboat with a whole bunch of barges filled with wheat grain, just full up, going upstream. And near Eads Bridge, one of the barges broke loose and floated down
and crashed
into the showboat. It didn't sink it, but structurally the problem ended up in a federal court. Chaperone, that was one of Mankey's big towboats.
Yeah, that's the best name possible,
they
isn't
were
it
pretty
yeah.
How the theater looked when we bought into it. In fact, one funny thing happened in the lobby. Frank Pearson dealing with Captain Bill. He always had a cigar and a smile. And they were talking about the price. Frank Pearson, $25,000. And Captain Bill said, $35,000 is more appropriate or something like that. And Frank started mentioning the restoration problems and everything. And while Frank was talking with Captain Mankey in his office there by the ticket window, he always had a cigar. Big hot coal out of his cigar fell on the floor. He didn't even notice it. And then you wonder how that fire started that he had such a problem with. And the balcony wasn't restored for a couple of years. So the Goldenrod, Frank brought it into business with the first deck only.
Oh.
So you had the theater and the seats.
Oh.
And then the downstairs bar. You come in past the ticket window, and that area was made into a bar.
Uh-huh. Well, this is beautiful. I really hadn't seen this photo very much before this. That's really a nice shot of the interior.
This was Captain Minky's stagehand.
Uh-huh.
That's not Red Skelton.
No.
His name is Memphis. I asked, how'd he get that name? He says, that's where he came on board.
Oh.
The Goldenrod.
So that's not necessarily where he was from, but that's where he boarded the boat.
And he just kind of worked as a deckhand. And when the band played and everything, he'd be up looking through the windows. Uh-huh. He really liked the band.
Oh, that's great.
Frank Pearson bought this boat. It was up for sale. He couldn't resist.
Nice boat. What is it?
That's the Becky Thatcher.
Oh, the Becky
Thatcher.
It got
its name.
Yeah.
And it worked along with the Goldenrod.
And, of course, the Becky Thatcher ended up moored and turned into a restaurant.
For a while, it worked along with the Goldenrod. Now, the second or third festival, look how many more musicians showed up.
Oh, yeah.
The first annual with those five
piano players. Five, six people, yeah.